The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, we give you thanks for this day that you have given us. Father God, we give you thanks for the precious gift of life. We thank you for friends. We thank you, Lord God, for moments of fellowship and for opportunities and privileges, Lord God, to hear your word, to hear you speak to us. O loving Father God, as we assemble to celebrate the life of our brother, we pray, loving Father God, that our eyes may be open to see you more clearly, our ears open, Lord God, to your holy word, and our hearts to receive and accept it. Father God, we ask these mercies along with, Father God, you know that as we enter your church, as we enter your house, it is a sacred place, and Lord God, we ought to be reverent. We ought to be respectful. And loving Father God, I pray for those on the outside that they will acknowledge. They don't have to acknowledge, Lord God, what I ask them to do, but they will come to a point there, Lord God, that they may respect you, to know that this is your church. Father God, we ask these things in the beautiful name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If we live to the Lord. And if we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing into this world, and we take nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. With faith in Jesus Christ, we receive the body of our brother Norman Alwyn for burial. Our brother was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore, with confidence, pray to God our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise him in the company of the saints. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day Norman, our brother. And Father God, we thank you for giving him to us, his family and friends, to know and love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth, until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Rest eternal grant unto him, O Lord.
Our opening hymn is 497. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Have the first of three tributes to our deceased brother, and this one is by Trevor Eversley.
Now, as I stand here, first of all, let me say a good evening to everyone, to the priests, our attendants, the choir, and all of you who are here to pay your final respects to Norman. It's not a tribute that I'm giving, neither is it a eulogy. I just want to share a few words with you about my departed brother. As you can see, I had a few words written, but I don't think that will come over as meaningfully as what I want to say. Those of you who are present here, will be here out of your appreciation for Norman. Norman was not an angel, neither was he the worst person. He had his own ways. And at some point in time, I know that there are those of you who would have had differences of opinion with him. But that's not to say that he did not have any compassion or anything like that. Usually, it was either his way or the highway. But despite all of that, there was a gentle side to him. A gentle side. And I share an experience I had with him. There was a period in my life when I was ill. And he came over, you know, to check on me. And there he was asking question after question. And I wasn't in any mood at that point in time to answer. And I just kept quiet. It got to such a point that I just scratched his head. And said, you, I would F, U, F, dash, 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 I, N, dash, come, knock you over that way. I gone from here. And he stormed out. But by 3 o'clock that evening, he came back to check on me again. He came back. Now those of you who are present, who will know of his kind nature. Many a time he would cook up a pot of food and share with those who came to visit him. I am sure if I were to ask to show by raising your hands how many of you were touched by his generosity at some point in time, I would have to say the eyes have it. No 2 ways about that. Now, I learned a lot from Norman because there are things about my family history that I didn't know, and he would share with me. One of the things he would complain about is the fact that the children of today don't have it tough. On more than one occasion, he would tell me how, when he was growing up, he was well disciplined by our grandfather. He told me that at nights, Anthony, the late departed Anthony, my elder sister Stephanie, and he would have to say their Lord's Prayer before they went to bed. It had to be synchronized. When they came to the end, one person said amen before the other two, wax for wax, and they had to start all over again, right, until they got it right. That was the type of discipline he had. And I believe that is one of the reasons why he didn't tolerate certain things from his children, that he wanted them to be like under his dominion. Norman's name was Elvis Presley. In his head, there's a young man, you know, being fair-skinned, handsome dude, and he had the gift of gab. Women were enamored by him, or with him, I should say. And they were bent to his will. And one of the good things out of those unions was the fact, as you will see here, four beautiful children. He was not the greatest of dads, because there were times when he was alienated from the children. But deep inside, he loved them all and would have done anything to help them. So there's just a few words I want you to share with you, to let you know that despite the negatives, despite his limitations, he was a human being like most of us. And I will hope that when you think of him, you will think of the good times you share with him and all the other communications that were well at those moments. So I thank you for listening, and I hope, my brother, that you will have peace from this moment on. Thank you.
We now have two musical tributes to our late brother, the first by Khadija Mosley and the second by Ajahn Phillips.
Good afternoon to the church. I know most of us here know this song, Waymaker, by Sinak. This was a request by his son, Trevor. So I would encourage everyone to sing along.
Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Hey, way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. Hey. Turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you. Come on. Hey, way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Hey, way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, that is who you are. You wipe away our tears. You mend the broken heart. You're the answer to it all. Jesus, you wipe away our tears. You mend the broken heart. You're the answer to it all, to it all. Jesus. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Yeah. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here. Turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, meeting every need. I worship you. I worship you. Thank you.
This song's from my granddad. May he rest in peace. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieve. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like the blood, his mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me, his word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be, as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like the blood, his mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like the blood, his mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace, unending love, amazing grace, unending love, amazing grace.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in your Son, Jesus Christ, you have given us a true faith and a sure hope. Strengthen this faith and hope in us all our days, that we may live as those who believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Our first Bible reading, taken from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, will be done by Andre Phillips. This will be followed immediately by Psalm 23, the Cremon version.
A reading from the Word of God, written in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, beginning at the first verse. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 to 8 and 14. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to laugh and a time to mourn. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to dance. A time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. I know that whatever God does endure forever. I know that whatever God does endures forever. Nothing can be added to it, nor anything taken from it. God has done this so that all should stand in awe before him. Here ends the reading.
Thank you.
second Bible reading taken from John chapter 14 will be done by Marilyn Eversley.
A reading from the Word of God written in John chapter 14, verses 1 to 6. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The word of the Lord.
The hymn before the homily is 496. And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood?
Thank you.
I speak to you in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. I would take nothing away from the grief that you feel today. And I would not say to you that everything is okay. I know that you are hurting, and I know you will hurt perhaps for a long time. And I believe that God made us so that we can have relationships with one another, and when that relationship is lost, we feel pain. You have lost a loved one, and it hurts. But I would like to speak a word of comfort today. And it comes from the second lesson read, John 14, 1 to 6. And from this passage of scripture, we find three thoughts of comfort. The first is that Jesus has promised us peace. Yes, today is a day of sadness, a day of grief, a day of mourning. Yet even in the midst of this, we can have peace. And why? Because we believe. We believe that even in the midst of the storm, even in the valley of the shadow of death, there can be peace that surpasses all understanding, because we know that God is with us. And the 23rd Psalm, also sung this evening, says to us, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will do what? Fear no evil, for thou art with me. My brothers and sisters in Christ, God is here in his house. He is present. And I implore you to believe and trust in him, and he will grant you that peace that you need. And not only this evening, but in any and every circumstance of your life. The second thought of comfort is that God has prepared a place for us. And Jesus says, I go to prepare a place for you. And the verse tells us that it is the Father's house. In his Father's house, there are many rooms. And that says a room for you and a room for me. And isn't that a comforting thought in itself? That God has prepared a place for us. What comfort it is to know that this miserable, chaotic, dark, and sinful world is not all there is, and death is not the end. The next thought of comfort is that God has prepared a way for us to get there. Everyone wants to go to heaven. Some just don't know the way. But Jesus tells us in John 14, he said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life, and no one comes to the Father but by me. And I would like to say that we are all travelers on a road called life. And there are many detours, there are many side streets, but we don't need to get confused. We don't need to get lost. All we need to do is to follow Jesus. He's the one who is the way, and he will show the way. He will lead us, he will guide us. And brothers and sisters, this evening, that in itself is comforting. Death is something that many of us try to think very little about, and yet, unless the Lord returns, we'll all go by the way of the grave. We will all die. Death carries for most people the fear of what happens next. And there is only one source that reveals the truth about life after death. And that source is the Word of God, the Holy Bible. And Hebrews 9:27 says, it is appointed unto man once to die, and after this the judgment. Death is something that we all must face when our time comes. But death needs not to be fearful for the one who trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. For he's the one who died for us. He's the one who overcame death. And the Bible is clear on the subject of death and eternal life. And in the 5th chapter of John's Gospel, Jesus said, "Search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and these are they which testify of me." The Word of God teaches that it is wonderful to do good works, but our good works can never earn us a place in heaven. Ephesians 2:8-9 says, "For by grace you are saved through faith, and that not of yourself, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." Every one of us must answer for ourselves before God, and it is not my place or yours to judge others. The Bible does say it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God, and we should be prepared to meet God in his lifetime and not wait before it is too late. This evening's reading from John's Gospel encourages us. "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, would I have told you? I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, so that where I am, there you may be also." Of all the passages of Scripture, of all the words of encouragement that Jesus gave, of all the verses that lend comfort to the human heart, this passage is one of the most beloved. And I can tell you that, you know, about 99.9% of the persons who come to arrange funerals for their loved ones choose this reading. It is one of the most beloved because it gives us as believers hope. And not only the hope of Christ's return, not only the hope of heaven and everlasting life, but the hope of peace and comfort for those who are going through times of trouble. It supports the writer of Psalm 46 and verse 1, which says, "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in times of trouble." Perhaps Jesus, knowing the scriptures well, had that psalm in mind when he spoke these words to his disciples. For he begins by saying, "Let not your heart be troubled." Jesus doesn't deny that trouble exists. He doesn't say we should attempt to escape the reality that sometimes life can be real hard. Rather, he gives reasons why we should take comfort. In the context of this passage, Jesus has been telling his disciples that he must leave them. He had told them on several occasions that he would be betrayed and arrested and tried and crucified. And the disciples either didn't believe or they didn't understand how this could possibly happen. After all, Jesus was the Messiah. He was the Son of God. And there are so many things his followers didn't understand. For at this point, they didn't understand that Jesus had to die as an atonement for sin. They didn't understand when he spoke of his departure into heaven, where he would be seated at the right hand of God the Father. They didn't understand that he would send the Holy Spirit to be their comforter, their guide, and their helper. They didn't understand all these things, yet Jesus gave them one simple instruction. And what was that instruction? Believe in God. Believe also in me. Do we believe in God? Huh? Do we believe in God? Will it take very long to answer? And this is something, you know, I really can't understand these days. I mean, believers should be shouting to the top of their voices. "Yes, I believe in God. I am a child of God. I believe in God. I believe he gave his life for me." And time after time, in funerals and even sometimes in church, I ask people a question, they sit down and they're so quiet. And one of the things that, you know, at our baptism, one of the things that the priest says, you know, that we should never be ashamed to confess Christ crucified. We should not be ashamed to say that we believe in God or to call God's name. We should be glad because it's a wonderful privilege. And do we believe in that Jesus is God's Son and our Savior? If not, then where do you place your trust? In yourselves? In others? Where do we place our trust if not in God and in His Word? And if one says there is no God, no everlasting life, what basis do we have hope? And if we discard the Word of God as just a silly ancient book which has no relevance for today, then where can we find the hope that we so dearly need as we travel life's journey? If we do not believe in the reality of God, if we do not believe and accept His Word, then all that we have to do is to eat and drink and be merry, for tomorrow you die. But the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ is that if we believe, if we have faith in God, that He sent His Son Jesus to die for us to be our Savior and save us from sin and eternal death, then these promises are for us. And Jesus is the most influential man in human history. And even those who do not believe in Him as their Lord and Savior still regard Him as a great prophet, a good man, a wise and moral teacher. Well, if a person really believes those things, do we not all have to take Jesus at His Word, God as His Father, and that in the Father's house are many mansions? Jesus speaks only the truth, and He says that if it were not so, what I have told you that it was so, God is not a liar. And Jesus continues to say, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And something everyone needs to realize, something that we all need to realize is that the Bible isn't just some religious text for people in general. Jesus isn't speaking in general terms. He's speaking in specific terms. And most importantly, He's speaking in personal terms. He has gone to prepare a place for you. And in this chapter of the Gospel of John, He's speaking to His disciples, yes, but by extension, He's speaking to every single individual who would place their personal trust in Him. How can we be assured of all that Jesus has promised? Do we believe that He will return and take us to be where He is? A lot of persons, sadly, in this day and age, do not believe. And we can, you know, we can see it so plainly around us. And there are some things I remember as a child growing up. Yeah, when you got to the church door, you had to be silent. You were silent and respectful, and you came in, you genuflected or bowed or whatever, and you sat in your pew, and you talked silently to God. But nowadays, and especially at funerals, there are so many things that are going on, I can't understand. People are disrespectful, yeah? They don't respect the church anymore, they don't respect God anymore. And almost every time we have a funeral here, and especially when there's a lot of people, we have the same problem under the porch. Persons have become very disrespectful. We have persons come in, and we go even going into the committals and pouring all sorts of things down in the grave. This is what the world, this is what Barbados, this is what society has come to. Perhaps some of us here today are asking, how can we know the way? Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. For those who are in Christ, we believe we shall see our brothers and sisters again, in the place that the Lord has prepared for His own. This is our hope, this is our faith, and our confidence is in the Lord our God. Brothers and sisters, funerals remind us of how short life is and how important it is to keep a right relationship with one another, because once that person has slipped out of this life, we can never tell them how much we love them or how much we appreciated all that they did for us. And we should all tell those whom we love how much they mean to us while we still have the opportunity. Life is too short, and it is far too short to ever withhold forgiveness for those who have done us wrong. All of us have lost loved ones, and it is never easy, no matter how many years they were with us. Thousands of years ago, a shepherd boy who would become the king of Israel wrote that Psalm 23, that like John 14 has blessed countless hearts and given peace and comfort to those who were suffering. And that man was David. And it is that said 23rd Psalm. And I would like the relatives and the friends of our dear brother to remember these words in addition to the word, Jesus' words, John 14, 1 to 6. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Continue that for me. May these words be your comfort, and may they bring you that peace that indeed surpasses all understanding. Let us stand in a firm of faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed in your booklet. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us kneel for our prayers.
At the end of each petition, your response will be, "Hear us, Lord." For our brother Norman, let us pray to the Lord Christ who said, "I am resurrection and I am life." Lord, you console Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Norman and dry the tears of those who weep. You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow. You raised the dead to life. Raise our brother to eternal life. You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our brother to the joys of heaven. Our brother was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give him fellowship with all your saints. He was nourished with the body and blood of Christ. Grant him a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom. Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our brother. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope.
Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to you our brother Norman, who was reborn by water and the Spirit in holy baptism. Grant that his death may recall to us your victory over death and be an occasion for us to renew our trust in your Father's love. Give us, we pray, the faith to follow where you have led the way and where you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit to the ages of ages. Amen. Father of all, we pray to you for Norman and for all those whom we love but see no longer. Grant to them eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. And may he and all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. Amen. Amen. I would just like to take this opportunity to extend on behalf of the congregation of St. Luke our sincerest condolences to the relatives, the family, and the friends of our departed brother. During our next hymn, we will be collecting an offering which will assist us with the upkeep of our graveyard.
Thank you.
Has done, so we're going to do that last verse and the chorus again.
Thank you.
voice from heaven saying, write this. Happy are the dead who die in the faith of Christ. Henceforth, says the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the record of their deeds. Man born of a woman has but a short time to live. Like a flower, he blossoms and then withers. Like a shadow, he flees and never stays. But in the midst of life, we are in death. To whom can we turn for help but to you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins? Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins. And at our last hour, let us not fall away from you.
In sure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our brother Norman Alwyn, and we commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we beseech you, in your infinite goodness, to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved Son shall come again in judgment, both this our brother Norman and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this, Lord, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, with whom still live the spirits of those who die in the Lord, and with whom the souls of the faithful are in joy and felicity, we give you heartfelt thanks for the good examples of all your servants who, having finished their course in faith, now find rest and refreshment. May we, with all who have died in the true faith of your holy name, have perfect fulfillment and bliss in your eternal and everlasting glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved, the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. And this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Rest eternal grant to him, O Lord.
And let light perpetual shine upon him.
May he and all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. The Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face to shine upon him and be gracious to him. The Lord lift up his countenance upon him and give him peace.
Amen.
Amen.
We shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirit shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessing of rest. In the sweet
by and by,
we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet
by and by,
we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
And the blood.
Let us pray. O God, the maker and redeemer of all mankind, grant us with your servant Norman and all the faithful departed the sure benefit of your son's saving passion and glorious resurrection, that in the last day when you gather up all things in Christ, we may with them enjoy the fullness of your promises through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And all unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever.
Amen.
Rest eternal grant unto him, O Lord.
Let light perpetual shine upon him.
May he and all the faithful departed rest in peace.
If you give a little more than you take, and if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time to help a stranger in the rain, there's a place for people like you. If you stand up for those down on their knees,
and lend a voice to those who cannot speak. If you shine a little light, give sight to the ones who've lost their way. There's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold. And when you get there, there's a hand to hold. When your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you. If you walk around with your heart on your sleeve, and if you're trying to be the change you wanna see, if you lay down your life for love so someone could be saved, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold. And when you get there, there's a hand to hold. Days down here or through, there's a place up there for people like.